Hi everybody. In this video, we're going to learn all about traversing the DOM. This is a topic that touches upon a lot of what we've already seen around how the DOM works, how it allows you to see the things you see on screen, but also ties in some of the material we'll be seeing in the future around how to create elements, how templating works, and how to do some of the more dynamic UIs that are possible using JavaScript and HTML and CSS as well. So let's get started. So as we know, our browser, what we see, is just a version of this of pixels and visuals that are really for us as humans. Behind the scenes, what we see is a tree-like structure. And this tree-like structure is what allows our page to look the way it does. You know, CSS relies on it for its cascade and styling, but so does the HTML to provide structure and guidance for what element does what and accessibility. And all these various things are largely determined by this tree-like structure that we see here and the branches and all the children that make it up. Now, navigating the DOM, kind of like a monkey, is an important skill for us to master because it's a key part of being able to modify, create, remove, and clone elements using JavaScript. And that touches upon what I mentioned earlier around being able to create more of the dynamic UIs that are going to be very critical for the kinds of things you want to build as a developer. Now, traversing a DOM sounds really vague and maybe even a little complex, but really there's two parts to it. The first part is just to find the element that you want to start off and, you know, start your explorations from. And the second part is around navigating the tree from that location you're basically in. So when we simplify it this way, it doesn't seem too complex. Now, let's talk about the first part, finding our elements. To find elements, there's nothing magical or surprising here. We can find elements in our DOM by relying on a variety of properties that have existed over the years and methods. QuerySelector and QuerySelectorAll are the cool ones that we all tend to rely on today. I'm not going to go into too much detail on this because I've spoken about this before. I've written about and recorded videos on how to use QuerySelector and QuerySelectorAll to find elements in DOM. So if you're not familiar with them, I encourage you to pause the video, take either a read or a watch, and then come back and we'll pick up from there. But the thing is, when navigating the DOM, there's a few more things that kind of have been introduced that maybe simplify our lives, maybe complicated. I don't know. Jury's still out on that one. Let's go back to our DOM. At the very top, almost always, there'll be three things that will always be there in the order you see them right now. Window, document, and HTML. And they each have a certain role, and I'll talk more about these particular properties at a much later date. But for now, know that the way you call them and the way you access them is not by using QuerySelector or QuerySelectorAll, though you can for some cases. The way you use them is by relying on these handful of properties exposed via window, document, and document.document element. And so to access the window object, it's a global, it's this window, document, global again, so you call it by document. And now once you have a document, to access the body and HTML element, you do document.body for the body element, and then document.document element for the HTML element. So just keep this information in the back of your pocket for when you might need it, because it is actually a very common way for you to start searching the DOM by relying on any of these properties. So, you know, even though I'm downplaying its interestingness, really, it's something you'll be using quite frequently. So we'll touch upon some of that stuff later. So that's the DOM, but there's more to our DOM than just those three elements. And for those, QuerySelector, QuerySelectorAll, get element by ID, get element by class name, all these things are still available for you to use. So those will be make up the bulk of the part one of this, which is finding the element you want to start our search from. So now it's time to get to the next stage, which is once we've found the element we want to, you know, start our search from there we can start branching out. And the way we can do that is by referring to an element's parents, siblings, and children. And at a very high level, it is exactly as what you might think it is. So here we have like another version of our DOM. Let's say the div is the element that we are currently, you know, on focusing on. And so for the div, its parent would be the body. Its siblings would be the script tag, sibling in this case. And its children would be the image, h1, p, and div. So if our div is our starting point, we have a parent, which is the body, we have some siblings, and we have children. That's a bird's eye view of what exactly happens in terms of the hierarchy and relationship between some of the elements. There's some more things that kind of go in there as well. And so the number of properties available to make this work, there's a lot here. You know, you have first child, first element child, last child, You can read all these properties. But the main thing to highlight is that when we talk about more generally in terms of like the elements and things that make up our DOM, we tend to often focus on the elements themselves, you know, often a representation of our markup or any elements that were created by a third-party library or script. But what really goes on in the DOM is a lot more things. You know, you have nodes, which is a more generic version of what we call elements, where you have text, you have comments, you have a variety of different things that we don't really see, and we don't really think about in terms of like our, you know, ability to author HTML, but they all play a key role as well. And that's why some of the properties you see here differentiate between a more general purpose item in the DOM and an actual element itself. So you have first child, first element child, last element child. For the most part, unless you're very particularly looking for a particular non-element item in your DOM or trying to get a more comprehensive view of everything that goes on in the DOM, you probably want to stick with the element equivalent. So we'll see some of that as part of the examples we'll look at. We'll probably focus on those things. And once we have, you know, here's a more detailed view of what that is. So let's say div again is our focus area. You can see the parent node points to body, script parent node points to body. You can see the relationship between like siblings, children, and parents, you know, in a very easy way using this kind of visualization. And it gets more complex in some cases, more simplified in others, but this is an approximation. And as you start using these properties to make your code do all these cool dynamic UI-like things, that's where we'll get into some of the more nitty-gritty details of what's going on. And the last thing we'll focus on is children itself. You know, we kind of talked about it visually, but now let's talk about what exactly this means. The first child or last child, in the case of the only one child, points to the same item. So our body to div is just the first child and last child properties go directly to it. But we also have the children property, which allows you to essentially kind of like an array, get a collection of values that make up the elements and items that are in your current DOM that you're starting from. So in this case, you have div.children.0 is the body's only child, and so you can access it by that. But the div element, though, has three children. You know, we have, image, image, and h1. And so for that, it's div.children.0, div.children.1, and div.children.2. So the same notation you might use for arrays in the past just works smoothly in a world where you have to deal with elements and children as well. And the part that I want to emphasize again, because that is an important one, it will trip you up if you aren't paying attention, is that not all the things in the DOM will be elements. So keep that in mind. So the properties we use will have elements as a part of them because we're looking for elements. But if you're not, a lot more things can be potentially available for us. Now, the easiest way to make sense of some of these things is to kind of just take a look at a very simple example of how this goes. So if you want to follow along, just open up the URL, your browser, and go to the URL bit.ly/traversingdom. And that should get you into an example that looks a little bit like this. This is from another tutorial I have on the site on how to build your first web page. So let me zoom in a bit and let me go and just bring up the inspector, the Chrome DevTools. And first, let's look at what the HTML for this one looks like. It's a very simple app for the most part. You have some elements, you have styles. I'll collapse that just to keep the area clean. You have a body element, you have a div, and you have, you know, it has two children, the p tag and a button. And then you have a script, which is some script that when you click this, gives you like changes the words to hello world. So nothing too fancy going on there. Now, let's say, for example, we actually want to just see how to use some of the properties we saw a little bit earlier. And so I'm just going to go ahead and go to the console. You can use a code editor if you want, copy and paste the markup and JavaScript and CSS and start from there. But I'm just going to use the code editor. I'm going to use body element equals document.body. And once you've done that, you can see that the body element has been undefined. But from here, though, I can actually see all the things that make up what goes through the body itself. So I have a pointer to the body element, and I can see pretty much the same view of what I saw earlier in terms of the items that are there. So let's say that we want to access the child that is a div element. So for that, I can do body element dot first child. Let's see first what first child returns, by the way. First child returned a text node, which is a whole lot of things that we don't really think about, right? This is a case where first child is not showing up here because this is a part of the nodes that are not elements that can also be found in a node. So this is a case where first child would maybe have returned the wrong thing if my goal was to access the div element. So instead, I'm going to do body element, and I'm going to do dot first element child. And if I do that, you notice that we get the div element that shows up as a part of this. And likewise, if I were to do first element child to last element child, one of the properties we saw earlier, I can see the script tag making its grand appearance. So pretty neat. But body element, of course, is also a collection. So I can do body element.children. And if I do that, you get an HTML collection object is returned. And you can now see div and script are some of the items that are currently inside it. And just clear this out so you have more room to see at the top. And so what it means, I can do like body element.children/0. And that is a div. And a div itself has children of its own. Like it has a p tag and a button tag. And a button element, sorry. And so what I can do there is I can either do query selector and go to the div element directly. Let me show you what that looks like. So let div element equals document.query selector. And since it's a very simple document, there's only one div, so I can just go ahead and call the div element directly. So I can now see div element, and now I can see all the values that make it up. And so this is really step one of the two steps that we talked about and how you navigate the DOM. I found the element I want to start from. But in this case, though, you know, instead of repeating the same things we talked about earlier, where I do first element child or last element child or children, let's continue with the body element navigation instead. So let me go ahead and clear the console one more time. Let's do body element dot children bracket 0. See, now we know that this is actually our div. And then from there, I can do children /0 again. And this will give us the p tag because we know, as we know, our actual markup here is our div has two items, both the div tag and a p tag and a button. And so children 0 gives us, you know, the p tag. If I do 1, I get the button. If I go on, I just want to go back all the way to children 0, I can just get there very quickly. But it's a very easy way to be able to navigate the DOM once you've found the element that you want using some of these properties there. And you can also go more elaborate as well. And in the comments, in the description for the video, I'll post the text version of this video where I actually wrote an article around this material where you can look at some snippets that how we allow you to more easily walk the DOM, traverse all the elements there. So if you want to just get a view of every element that makes up your current page, there's a script that allows you to do all of that. And so those things will make more sense now that you've seen a high level overview of some of these properties that make navigating a DOM just really straightforward. All right, we covered a lot of ground in this topic of DOM traversal. We talked about how you find the element that you want, simple, usual ways we've done it before, query selector all. Of course, if you like to go old school, you have get element by ID, get elements by class name, and then a bunch of other properties that we've looked at, like window, document.body, document.document element, and so on. And the second part, of course, is the more fun part, in my opinion, around once you found the element you want to start the traversal from, you have all these properties for finding your children, finding your parents, finding your siblings, and the little differences between finding the ones that are elements and find the ones that are more general nodes that just happen to have content or DOM that they can easily access in case you didn't realize our DOM had other things beyond HTML elements, which is a surprising thing if you aren't too familiar with this area. So to wrap things up, to learn more, go to crypt.com. Have any questions, post in the forums. Probably the fastest and bestest way of getting in contact for any questions you might have. Posting on the comments here, not a bad way, but I don't check it as frequently, and the formatting options are limited that it's just very difficult to make sense of what's going on. And so the best way to share your knowledge with others is to tell your friends and enemies. Well, actually teaching it is probably the best way to share knowledge, but for now, just tell your friends, tell your enemies, pets, whoever's interested on DOM traversal to check this video out. Hit subscribe to be notified of new videos when they come out. Follow me on Twitter and Facebook. And of course, there's a book if you are still into reading things on these little devices called Kindles. You know, I'm not sure if it's popular anymore. Or if you like this physical book thing where like an actual tree gets chopped down and like, you know, turned to a pulp and like really horrific things happen to the tree. But if you like that stuff, great, more power to you. There's a book there, JavaScript, Absolute Beginner's Guide, written by me, where topics like this and others can be found. I should totally be in sales. Talk to you all next time.